It's customary for Muslims to begin by invoking the name of God in this hallowed space, this cathedral of St. Mark. It is indeed, and thank you, Mark, for all you've done, to invoke the name of God, the one God, the God of Adam, the God of Noah, the God of Abraham, the God of Ishmael and Isaac, the God of Moses and Aaron, the God of Jesus, the God of Mary, the Mother of Jesus Christ, and the God of Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon all these noble prophets and messengers. I'd like to thank you very much for all being here tonight. And I know that many of you are here observing the beginning of an important conference on certain sentiments that some people have towards Islam. It is not, or rather it is very important that we as Americans have a good relationship with a faith that is adhered to by almost one quarter of the global population. It is not in our interests, whether we have geopolitical interests of the United States of America, economic interests, or national security interests, to have a tense relationship or a negative relationship with Muslims. Moreover, never in the history that I have studied have religious wars resulted in the demise of any religion. The Crusades did not result in the demise of Islam or Christianity. Religious wars in any two religions have never resulted in the demise of religion. But I do not know of any instance in which a political regime took on religion and succeeded. The almighty Roman Empire tried to destroy Christianity, throwing Christians to the lions, oppressing them, killing them. But after three centuries, Rome became the capital of the Catholic Church, the Roman Catholic Church, which has survived and has thrived for over 1,000 years. And the almighty Roman Empire was no more. The Soviet regime tried to destroy all religion. And in 70 years, communism is now a footnote in history. And all religions are coming back, you might say, with a vengeance in the ex-Soviet republics. The Nazis tried to destroy Judaism by committing the worst genocide in human history, by exterminating 6 million Jews and trying to exterminate Judaism completely from the face of the earth. And the Jewish state of Israel was born on the still warm embers of the Third Reich. And as many of my Jewish friends, a kind of a renaissance even in Jewish culture. So for America, for some people who would like to suggest that America should be at war against Islam, is something that is completely incoherent, completely insane, and does not make any sense whatsoever. But more importantly, America shares with Islam certain fundamental principles of what the social contract of human beings should be all about. Founding fathers wrote in our Declaration of Independence that we hold certain truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, endowed by the Creator with certain unalienable rights, among which are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Now, this very language, and it goes on to talk about the laws of nature and the natures of God, this language is a religious language. This language may not be parochially Christian or Jewish or Muslim, but it is fundamentally in sync with the common values and principles of the Abrahamic faith traditions. The notion of the equality of all men, of all people, regardless of their race or ethnicity, is a fundamental principle of the Abrahamic faith traditions. And 5 centuries before these words were penned by our founding fathers, Muslim jurists and the fall of Islamic law is to further and support the overarching objective of the law, of the sacred law, which is to further the interests of human beings in this life and in the next, in the hereafter. And they unpack these objectives into 6 major objectives. The protection and furtherance of life, of dignity, of property, of intellect, of family, and of religion. And this is why I say that this statement is very much in sync with what Muslims call the maqasid of the Sharia, the objectives of Islamic law. And I'm in fact in the paper which was published recently by the law journal of the University in Minnesota, in which I map these comparisons and show life is similar, dignity maps to liberty, and what do to pursue our happiness? We seek material gain, we seek profit, we seek to marry the ones we love and have a family, we seek our intellectual development, and we seek our religious pursuits. This is why when we think, and when I think, of what America stands for and why I love America, it's because America is a country that was based upon a set of principles. We may not have been perfect in American history at the very beginning in terms of race relationships, but those fundamental concepts are true. They ring true, and every human being all over the world embraces these ideas and these ideals and wants to establish a society that is built on those principles. And this is why the notion of law is common to Christians and Jews and Muslims. When Jesus was asked, what is the greatest commandment? He said, it is to love the Lord thy God with all of your heart, all of your mind, all of your soul, and all of your strength. I'm conflating 2 quotations in 2 different Gospels here. And then he said, the second commandment is like unto it, the St. James version of the Bible that I'm most familiar with. It means it's equal with the first commandment, which is to love thy neighbor as thyself. And then he says, this is something which a lot of people don't remember, upon these 2 commandments hang all of the law and all of the prophets. And the scholars of Islamic law, the doctors of Islamic law, actually built what we call Sharia law, Islamic law, from these 2 commandments. In fact, they divided all of law into law pertaining to the first commandment of loving God, or worshipping God, what we call acts of worship, or ibadat in Arabic, or laws pertaining to what we call worldly affairs, mu'amalat. Then they unpacked these areas of law into laws of criminal law, personal status law, law of contracts, law of the environment, law of how to treat animals, law of nations, law of governance. And this shows the common heritage that we have, the common values that we have, values which on which we can build a global social contract. And that is what the world wants today. What we are seeing in what many people are calling the Arab Spring around the Arab world today, the desire of people to have the values that we have here, to have what we call in America life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness deliverables. This is what the world wants. This is what is common in terms of the responsibility of good governance according to Islamic principles or jurisprudence. And unlike what many people believe, the Quran and the tradition of our jurisprudence and our history speaks to the fact that we must protect religious freedom, freedom of religious conscience, and freedom of communities to practice their religions as they see fit. Many may not know this, but the second caliph after the Prophet, Umar ibn Khattab, when the Muslims conquered Palestine, the Christian patriarch went to greet him, and they welcomed them because they knew they would protect them. And in fact, it was Umar ibn Khattab who invited 70 Jewish families to take up residence in Jerusalem from the area of Tiberias, the Syrian Turkish border. For the first time after Jews were evicted by the Romans in 70 AD. So the notion that Muslims and Jews have always been at odds is a myth that is disproven by centuries of history, whether in the region of the Levant, whether in southern Spain, in North Africa, but in almost every region where Muslims were, relationships between Jews and Muslims and Christians were very good indeed. It has not been until recently, in the last century, maybe half a century, that these relations began to shift as a result of political changes and certain political agendas. But those of us who understand the theology, the jurisprudence, and the historical tradition of our religion have to emphasize these facts, have to amplify them, and have to work very hard to establish a global community, a global society, in which these principles are brought back and upheld. I therefore pray for a time, which I hope will come very soon, the Prophet Isaiah predicted, that nations will not war against other nations and will not learn war anymore. And I'm increasingly optimistic that this time is indeed much nearer than we may think. Let us pray to God.
أشهد أن محمدا
Also, what we have in common is the importance of love and compassion. And the Christians emphasize love, hope, and charity. And Muslims, you know, we talk of God as being the all-compassionate, all-merciful, and that we are to be compassionate and caring. I think that's one thing that certainly our faith should have in common, as we have many, many other things in common. But if we, and the world needs more love and more compassion, no doubt about it. And to the extent we can enhance those aspects of our respective faith traditions, we will have to improve the world today. Because between Christians and Muslims, I think together we are over half of the world population. I think of spirituality as well. We believe that much of the oppression which has occurred towards women is cultural and not religious. It happened in this society essentially 100 years ago, 200 years ago. Women didn't have the right to an education or to vote even in this country. And much of what we see in the Arab Muslim world and even in the non-Muslim world like in China, Japan, is really cultural. And these things will change as more women get educated. And today, two-thirds of the university population in the Gulf countries and in Iran are women. And as women get more economically, get jobs and inherit wealth, you will see, just like what happened in American society, a greater result towards equity and equality. The project that my wife and I have started, the Women's Initiative in Spirituality and Equality, is something that we are very proud of. We've done a couple of projects, one in Egypt and one in Afghanistan. One in Egypt is to end female genital cutting, as they call it, a horrible act, which is not part of our religious tradition. It's an African tradition, which many people think mistakenly in Africa that it is in fact religiously sanctioned. And in Afghanistan, we've done a project to educate imams who preach in the Friday sermons to make sure that they educate their daughters and give them their full rights. And you can go to our website or call our office to get more information about that. I'll never forget the story of when I was, how old was I then? 1997, about 25 years old. An Egyptian gentleman who was a chain of shish kebab stores Middle East actually now. I came and I accompanied him in America. He was looking for his childhood friend, Egyptian Jew, we grew up with. We finally traced him in Kansas City. And it was like two long lost brothers who met again. And I realized how much of a loss Egypt had when Egypt stopped being the multicultural society it was. It had Jews, we still have Christians, we had Greeks. Many people don't realize that Alexandria was a major Greek city until the late 50s, early 60s, 1960s. We had Italians, we had Armenians, we had everybody. And with the rise of the Nasser and Arab of socialism, many of these people left, and with their leaving, Egypt became impoverished. As I told Edgar Bronfman, an important Jewish leader, is imagine what would happen to America if after 1948 all the Jews left America for Israel. What would America have been like in education, in film industry, in business, in trade, you name it? That's what happened to Egypt. Why does America love immigrants? Because immigrants enrich our society. Why does Silicon Valley? Why does Silicon Valley want to be able to bring the best brains from all over the world? Because that is what has maintained America's creative leadership. And what has happened to much of the Arab world is by doing a reverse emigration, you have impoverished our societies, not only in terms of actual capital, but intellectual capital most importantly, and what that creates. This is what the Arab world needs today. And if you look at the development in the Gulf, in Dubai, in the Emirates, who are the ones who are developing it? It's the expatriates from all over the world who are being brought to that part of the world to help develop their economies. So we need, God created us deliberately to be multi-ethnic, multicultural. The Quran says we created you from one male and one female, and we forged you into tribes and nations so that you would get to know one another. The ta'arafu, as it says. So this is almost a divine, for us, a divine commandment, which we have ignored. We have violated. So this is important. And by building these multicultural societies is going to be an important factor, and I pray that that will happen soon. As far as your question on the transition to Quran, there's a thing, an Italian expression, maybe it's even Latin, traditore, traditori, which means the translator is a traitor. It's impossible to translate any more than you can translate a Mozart opera written in German into Italian, or to translate, Puccini, composed in Italian, to sing it in English. It doesn't sound the same. So the Quran is viewed to be the Quran only in Arabic. However, translations exist into many languages, and I have my favorites. Muhammad Ali is one of the most accurate translations. But if you get Arbery was an English professor of Islamic studies, and he translated the Quran. And we tried to capture the rhythm of the Quran. Arthur Arbery's translations are not as accurate, but his two introductions to part one, part two, is worth reading, because he talks about what he found to be the pull of the Quran. But it's important to know that the Quran is a primary source. It's believed by Muslims to be literally the word of God inspired to Muhammad. And the Quran and the teachings of the Prophet and his precedents are the basis of what we call Sharia. The word Sharia is not found in the Quran, actually. And this found in the Quran, but doesn't refer to what it later, that term later began to denote, namely our law. And I think I did give a little description about Sharia law. It is based upon the teachings of the Quran, which are common. And the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt honor thy parents, and thou shalt not take the name of God in vain. We sort of memorize all the Ten Commandments. These are our commandments as well. So they form part of what is called Islamic law or Sharia law. And by the way, Sharia law demands that Muslims must obey the law of the land that they live in. And there are many aspects of Sharia law, apart from the penal code, which when people talk about Sharia law and the fear of Sharia law, it's not the penal code. We don't want to apply the penal code either. And the mistake which many Muslims have done is that they want to establish an Islamic state, and they start by applying the penal code of Islam. That's like saying, if you want to bring us down democracy, let's punish criminals the way Americans punish criminals, and we'll have a US-style democracy. How stupid is that? We Muslims can be very stupid, by the way, and happy. But what's important to remember is that many aspects of Sharia law, which currently practice, are not a problem in America. Our dietary laws, like kosher laws, halal food, that's part of our law. Practicing our acts of worship, we are protected. We have no problem doing that. We have no problem. I am licensed by the state of New York to conduct marriages according to Islamic law. That's like Sharia law. So, we're free to do that. We are free to dispose of our estates according to Islamic law. Islamic law requires us to bequeath a minimum to our immediate family and children. We cannot disinherit any of our, your so-called required beneficiaries. You can give away a maximum of one-third of your estate. At least two-thirds of your estate has to be distributed between the must-have categories, which are your spouse and your children. And if you don't have any children, then your parents or your siblings may then get a share of your estate. But that is the requirement of Islamic law. It doesn't conflict with American law. And in fact, the requirement, in fact, there's a whole new industry today of Islamic banking, Islamic investments, which are in line with what I call green investments today. You know, investments that do not pollute the environment, because our law prohibits us from poisoning the water supply or poisoning the air. And there has been an attempt, increasing attempt, to make sure that those who invest, let's say, stocks, do not invest in weapons and firearms, in things that destroy humanity and our environment. As far as Obama's Cairo speech, it was very important, and in fact, I supported this idea. And if you read page 253 of my book, you will see the inspiration, how I critique President Bush for not having taken the advantage of his opportunity when he first went to Baghdad, not to speak to the Iraqi people, to the Muslim world, because, as I mentioned, the creed of Islam, he went and said, I believe in God, I believe in the angels, I believe in the scriptures, I believe in the prophets, and I believe in the day of judgment. Translated to Arabic, that's the Muslim creed. And I know that President Bush believes in those things. So there are many things that an American president can say about his beliefs as a person, as a Christian, as an American, that to Muslims would sound, hey, we're both in the same boat, intellectually speaking, and as far as beliefs are concerned. So Obama's speech played a very important role, and I praise the Obama administration not only for bringing bin Laden to justice, but also for encouraging the current Arab spring, as they call it today, towards democracy. Because that is one of the most important factors in enhancing our national security and preventing the young people from joining Al-Qaeda. Because part of Al-Qaeda's draw was the fact that many of these regimes were actually terrorist regimes. They terrorized their own populations with Qaddafi, whether it's Bashar al-Assad of Syria and his father, who killed 20,000 people in the town of Hama back in the 1980s. They were brutal. They brutalized their people. They did not have a government that was of the people, by the people, for the people. It was a government that was for the government, regarding the assets of the land, whether it's oil or the people, it's belonging to that elite and serving them. This is why there was a lot of frustration and anger in the Muslim world. As I've often said, were there democracy in Saudi Arabia, then Laden would have run for political office. But when people do not have, this is why democracy is important. Democracy is not only the concept of a government that serves its constituents, which is what Islam requires. Democracy is also the ability to peacefully change our governments, to have a peaceful change of regime, not to have to kill the leader of the regime. So there are many aspects of democracy which are fundamentally at odds with the aspirations of the people, but with the principles and teachings of Islam as well, in terms of what a governor, the requirements of a ruler, the responsibilities of a ruler to those that he or she rules. And this is why I'm very optimistic and hopeful that that our support of the aspirations of these people to have what we call in this country democratic systems, governments that really care about their people and care about the development of their people, and our ability to encourage that will make people love us more, will reduce the animosity towards the United States of America, and help further the kinds of better relationships or betterment of British citizen in America, the land that I love and my citizen of, and the world of Islam, the religion that I also love and am a part of. Thank you very much.
יש מינינו דיבורים שעד קולו נשמעו אנחנו כאן בשביל כולם אנחנו גשר וסולם
בשביל מי שחולם בשביל מי שחלם
ואו בימינו נשיר בקולנו הבאנו שלום עלינו Havenu shalom alenu, havenu shalom alenu, shalom alenu, havenu shalom alenu, havenu shalom alenu, havenu shalom alenu, shalom alenu, shalom alenu.